हेलो एवरीबॉडी। तो आज का सेशन पॉलिटिकल साइंस आंसर राइटिंग के ऊपर है कि हम ऑब्जेक्टिव है कि आपको 300 प्लस मार्क्स कैसे स्कोर कराना है पॉलिटिकल साइंस आंसर राइटिंग में। देखिए, पढ़ते हम बहुत कुछ हैं, लेकिन उसका यूज़ तब तक नहीं है जब तक मार्क्स नहीं आते। तो जो भी कुछ हमें पढ़ना है वो इस तरह से पढ़ना है कि हमें मार्क्स आएँ, ठीक है। और कोई भी टीचर सही पढ़ा रहा है ख़राब पढ़ा रहा है वो आप कैसे डिसाइड करेंगे, जब तक आप आंसर सॉल्व नहीं, जब तक क्वेश्चन सॉल्व नहीं कर पाते। तो इम्पॉर्टेंट ये है कि क्वेश्चंस कैसे सॉल्व करना है और यूपीएससी की रिक्वायरमेंट क्या है, क्योंकि हमें समझना होगा कि हम कोई एग्ज़ाम दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी का नहीं लिख रहे, हम यूपीएससी का एग्ज़ाम लिख रहे हैं। और वो एग्ज़ाम एक रिक्रूटमेंट एग्ज़ाम है और वो इसलिए लिया जा रहा है कि वो सही ब्यूरोक्रेट को आइडेंटिफाई कर सके। तो यहाँ पे जो आंसर राइटिंग स्किल हो जाती है ना, वो थोड़ा सा डिफरेंट हो जाती है। जनरली दो तरह के कैंडिडेट होते हैं, एक होता है जो या तो पॉलिटिकल साइंस ग्रेजुएट होगा, या दूसरा होगा जिसने पॉलिटिकल साइंस कभी पढ़ा नहीं होगा। जिसने पढ़ा नहीं होता उसके लिए चैलेंज है, क्योंकि कोई इंजीनियरिंग बैकग्राउंड से मैक्सिमम स्टूडेंट्स, तो उसके लिए चैलेंज ये होता है कि यार इंजीनियरिंग में तो मैथमेटिकल इक्वेशंस लिखते हैं, कभी ह्यूमैनिटीज़ का आंसर ज़्यादा लिखा नहीं होता, तो कुछ आइडिया नहीं होता कि कैसे लिखना है। और जिन्होंने पढ़ा होता है पॉलिटिकल साइंस, उनके लिए भी चैलेंज होता है, वो ये कि क्योंकि वो अपनी ग्रेजुएशन में, बिकॉज दे राइट सो मच टू लेंथी आंसर्स इन देयर ग्रेजुएशन, राइट। बट हियर वी हैव टू राइट प्रिसाइसली इन 200 टू 250 और 300 वर्ड्स डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द वेटेज ऑफ द क्वेश्चन, ओके। सो फर्स्ट वी विल गाइड यू दैट वट इज़ द रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ दिस एग्जामिनेशन, वट यूपीएससी इज लुकिंग फॉर इन एन कैंडिडेट, राइट। वंस यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट वट यूपीएससी इज लुकिंग फॉर इन अ कैंडिडेट, देन ओनली यू विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड वट काइंड ऑफ ए आंसर विल फैच यू गुड मार्क्स। दैट्स नंबर वन थिंग। सो फर्स्ट वी विल डिस्कस वट यूपीएससी इज लुकिंग फॉर इन अ कैंडिडेट। नंबर वन थिंग दैट you have read some of you might have read second ARC report, right? So in that report there are certain values that a civil servant aspirant must have: impartiality, honesty, integrity, all these kind of things, right? These values are important not just to write when the question is asked on those values, not just to write in ethics, but these values must reflect in all of your answers. Like you are impartial, like you are honest, like you have integrity, right? So these values should reflect in your answer, examiner knowing that, reading your answer, examiner easily understand that this person has these kind of qualities. The question comes that how are you going to reflect these values in your answers, right? So this is the biggest challenge. So when it comes to impartiality, then you, because you are writing in political science, and political science can be really divisive, right? Okay, so political science can be really divisive because there are lots of ideologies, lots of political thinkers giving diverse opinions, right? So everybody as a human being is bound to have inherent biases towards certain idea and ideology, right? So if, for example, you might like Marxism very well, somebody might like liberalism and neoliberalism very well, right? So you should understand that these biases should not reflect in your answer. Your answer should be balanced. It should look that you are an impartial person, right? Because what you have to do as a bureaucrat is to execute a task, is to form policies, implement them in the welfare of the all people. That means you have to take into consideration the diverse interest of the society. For that, whatever is good, if something is good in neoliberalism, you will extract from that. Something is good in Marxism, you will extract from there, right? So that means that approach has to be reflected in your answer. So when you are writing something, if you are writing a critique, then that critique has to be balanced. If you are writing an opinion, that opinion has to be balanced. That means it has to take into consideration different, you should not ridicule or condemn an idea. That's summary, right? If question is on marks, that you should write a optimistic conclusion about marks. It should not look that you are ridiculing or condemning him, right? You should highlight the good things and you should highlight the bad things. That's number one thing. Second thing, when you are going to take decisions, you cannot take decisions based on hearsay, right? You got to take decision based on credible information, right? And that information has to come from somewhere, right? So if you are writing opinions of reputed scholars, thinkers in your answer to substantiate your viewpoint, that then examiner will see that you are forming your opinion based on credible evidence, right? So it's not that you are just saying something based on hearsay, right? The same knowledge can have rickshawala, the same knowledge you can have, but what is the difference? A bureaucrat a bureaucrat is supposed to form or his opinion based on credible information. He cannot form his opinion based on hearsay. Even if you form your opinion based on hearsay, you should look like you have formed it on the basis of credible information. So that's why arguments from reputed scholars in support of your argument to substantiate, recommendations from certain committees, you might use valuable judgments from Supreme Court, for example, Minerva Mill case. Justice Bhagwati wrote very good piece on justice. He discusses what is justice. So when you are writing about justice, then you can simply quote Justice Bhagwati in support of your argument in Minerva Mill's case. So basically, first thing that you should reflect the diversity by reflecting that you have impartial attitude towards all the thoughts and ideas. Second thing, you form your opinion based on credible information. It should not look like that you have just cooked up some opinion, okay? And then we have an important aspect, that is integrity. I will discuss a little bit about integrity, then I will give you an example how this can be reflected in your answer. And how UPSC is deliberating testing you. UPSC is deliberately testing you that you, if you are a man of integrity or not. Okay. You know, integrity, I call it virtue of virtues. Because if you may be honest, you may be hardworking, you may be impartial, you have all the kind of values. But if you don't have integrity, then those values are meaningless. Reason is that today you may be honest, but tomorrow if some political pressure comes, you might succumb to that pressure. Okay, you will change your opinion on the basis of pressure, right? So where is the integrity? Integrity is the wholesomeness of the individual. That means you stick to your opinion whatever the condition is. If you are honest, you are honest. If you are impartial, you are impartial. If somebody pays you bribe, that suddenly you turn impartial. You twist the policies in favor of somebody else, right? So this should not happen. That's why integrity is virtue of virtues, right? Or UPSC is deliberately designing the paper in a manner that it tests your integrity. For example, in ethics paper or as well as in other papers, there was a question, I think in 2018, they have asked about neoliberal Indian foreign policy is guided by neoliberalism. How far you agree to that view? Okay. Now you have seen the statement and you have asked to discuss or evaluate or critically analyze or whatever. Now you feel that if I go against the statement, then I might lose marks. If I support the statement, I might gain marks. So what happens? You invariably support the statement and form your opinion based on the above statement and justify it. Okay. Just three questions below, there was a question on change and continuity in Indian foreign policy. Now you are taking completely opposite stand of what you have said in first question. Because now you have to highlight change as well as continuity, right? So what will it reflect? It will reflect that you, in order to fetch more marks, यू आर चेंजिंग योर ओपिनियन, राइट? सो यू आर बेसिकली नॉट सेटिस्फाइंग, यू बेसिकली वट ट्राइंग टू अचीव योर सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट, राइट? यू नो दैट योर सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट इज इन स्कोरिंग गुड मार्क्स, सो दैट्स वाई यू आर चेंजिंग योर ओपिनियन, राइट? सो टुमारो इफ यू बिकम अ ब्यूरोक्रेट एंड यू विल फाइंड दैट योर इंटरेस्ट इज इन चेंजिंग policy or twisting the policy in order to favor somebody, then you will twist it, right? So this is the problem that UPSC don't want, that its candidate or would be candidate have. So that's why they are deliberately designing the question paper in such a manner that whatever the candidate comes up, they have these qualities. So we have to understand these things. In ethics paper also, I think in 2018 itself, there was a question on means are more important than end, right? They gave a statement and you realizing the statement invariably went in favor of means. And 3-4 questions later, there was a question just reverse of that. They gave another statement and in that statement, the argue was in favor of ends, that ends are more important than means. So in order to take more marks, again, the student fell into the same trap. So you have to stick to your opinion. And that's why it is very important to argue balance opinion. Because if 2 or 3 questions later, if the question is twisted, if you have taken balanced argument in earlier question, then it is easy for you to take balanced argument in next question as well. Right? Getting my point? If you have already taken an extreme stand, then in the next question, you will stop, right? You have already hardwired yourself into a position from which you cannot move out, right? So you have to leave enough space for yourself so that if whatever question comes 2 or 3 questions later, you can still have enough scope to maneuver. That's why always it is very important to write balanced answers. Okay, let's discuss some of the topics. See, political theory and approaches. This is the first topic, okay? But the thing is, it is difficult for you to understand in the beginning itself, right? So we will deal with this topic in later part of the course, okay? We will start with the Western political thought. You know, this is the foundation. So first we will deal with Western political thought. Once the foundation base is prepared for that, then we can easily move on to other topics like political meaning and approaches, because initially you will not understand these meanings and approaches. Okay, so we will move systematically in this regard. Then we will discuss the importance of syllabus and what are the more important areas in the syllabus. Okay, importance of syllabus is that if you remember syllabus by heart, then you are able to know and predict the question paper. That's the first. Writing well is as important as predicting the paper, right? If you don't understand question, you cannot predict the paper. For example, if you are reading newspaper, how are you going to identify which topic is important, which you should read and which you should not read? Until unless you have understood the syllabus, you cannot identify it. Right? So in order to identify, it is very important to understand the syllabus. So first thing that you got to memorize it, and not just memorize it, but you have got to understand the syllabus, right? So for example, if democracy is there, classical and contemporary theory, you must understand what is classical, what is contemporary, difference between them, or different models of democracy, representative, participative, and deliberative, right? So that means you should have separate short notes prepared for all those topics, right? Once you understand the syllabus, second thing we will do is provide previous UPSC questions from the relevant topic of the syllabus. That means you will know that, okay, from this topic, these kind of questions can come. Because seeing questions in light of the syllabus will enhance the understanding of the syllabus itself. Okay. So once the understanding of the syllabus itself is enhanced, then you are able to predict the possible question that can come out of the syllabus. Okay. Now, we will discuss important things in this. Liberal, neoliberalism, Marxism, pluralist, and postcolonial. Okay. You know, लिबरलिज्म, न्यू लिबरलिज्म, मार्क्सिज्म, दीज थ्री थिंग्स एवरीबडी विल बी चैम्पियन ऑफ. ओके, एवरीबडी स्पेंड्स टू मच टू मैनी आवर्स इन दीज थिंग्स, लिबरलिज्म, न्यू, बिकॉज दे आर द कोर एंड दे हैव टू. इट्स नॉट दैट दे डोंट हैव टू, दे हैव टू, बट पीपल नेग्लेक्ट प्लूरलिज्म, पोस्ट कॉलोनियलिज्म एंड फेमिनिज्म. इफ यू सी कंसिस्टेंटली यूपीएससी हैज आस्क क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम दीज थ्री. Sometimes they have asked ecofeminism. Sometimes this year itself, I think they have asked post-colonial theory of state, 2020 itself, right? So that means UPSC knows what you are strong at, what you are weak at. And deliberately, they are also picking questions specifically from those areas where you are weak at, right? And why they have to do? Because they have to eliminate. If everybody writes good answer, how are they going to judge a candidate? So, or and they knows where the candidates are strong and where the weak, because they are evaluating the copies every year. So they knows the weakness, the general weakness in the aspirants, and they design the paper accordingly. Okay. So we will also focus specifically on the areas which most of the candidates lacks, and UPSC never ignores those areas. Right? For example, we have taken one example, we can take one more example. Conception of justice with special reference to Rawls. Rawls theory. Okay. Ab everybody reads Rawls. It's not that nobody reads, but what UPSC asked? They asked democratic equality. In no book you will find it, the term democratic. In every book you will find theory of Rawls, but not in the context of democratic equality. But it's the same thing, it's not different. But UPSC asks the same thing in different manner. Right? So you got to not just focus on the neglected areas, but you also focus on the every aspect of a thinker. As many aspects of a thinker as possible. Because in Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, every year they are asking different things. You will find some things in some books, but not in those books, and some things in some other books, right? But you cannot end up purchasing 8 books for just one topic, Indian political thinkers, no, right? But they are asking every year different topics, different from a particular thinker. Similarly, as I've give example of John Rawls, right? So you got to be prepared for that, but you cannot buy so many books, right? Neither it's financially good, but also it's not good for your preparation, because if you buy so many books, you will lose valuable time, because you have to study them, you have to find out the relevant things as per your syllabus, and then you go, you know, so you multiply your effort. That's why we will simplify it for you, right? You don't have to buy it. I have those books, I have studied it, I have studied the syllabus, and I will pick relevant things from those, and I will frame questions and provide you. Another aspect that we will focus is we will also incorporate in our test series, in our answer writing, the previous year's questions. That is very important. You know, I am not going to set a question for UPSC. It's the UPSC which is going to. So it is very important to understand the psyche of UPSC. So once we pick the questions from previous year's UPSC questions, we will also discuss and provide you model answers. Then automatically a model answer will be ready with you for most of the UPSC previous year questions, important questions. That means your effort is reduced, because once UPSC also tends to repeat the questions. Role of property in liberalism, Locke, etc. They have asked at least 4 to 5 times. Same question. In fact, in 2 years, they have repeated the same statement from John Locke. 2 years in UPSC. So that means they have the tendency to repeat their questions, right? So if you have model answers ready for those questions, that means if you get 3 to 4 repeated questions in UPSC, and you have read in your model answers, then you can straight away fetch easily, round about 40 marks out of 60 marks, 60 to 70 marks or whatever the weightage it is, you can easily fetch, because 10% of the questions are directly repeated every year. राइट. सो बाय प्रोवाइडिंग यू डिस्कशन ऑन प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस एंड गिविंग यू द मॉडल आंसर, दैट मीन्स यू हैव यू विल ऑल्सो हैव द एक्स्ट्रा एज ओवर अदर कैंडिडेट्स. बिकॉज मोस्ट ऑफ द टॉपर्स ऑल्सो हैव सेड दैट दे यूज टू प्रिपेयर मॉडल आंसर फॉर द प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चन. दैट हेल्प्स इन रिविजन, राइट. That makes them systematic because by reading again and again those model answer, your mind is basically trained about how to write an answer, right? The more you read and write the ideal answers, the more your mind is trained, and the easier it will be for you to write in exam. Okay, and then again political ideologies. Socialism, Marxism, Feminism, Gandhism. Again, there are some neglected areas. Fascism, Feminism, Gandhism. These are again neglected areas by the student. And UPSC is consistently asking questions from these areas. Now, they have rarely touched these two things, Dharma Shastra and Arthashastra. Right? In 2020, they have asked Indian tradition. And it is, even if UPSC asks it or not, it is very important for you to know these things. The reason I will tell you. If you know these things, Buddhist traditions and all, you have knowledge of Indian thoughts, Indian thinking and Indian system of ideologies. Okay. You can use these things even if it is asked or not asked in your answers. Have you read Plato? Okay. In Plato, he's talking about three virtues: appetite, courage, and reason. Okay, everybody must have these. In every individual, one of these virtues is dominant. Okay, if somebody is courageous, then he must be made warrior and put into army. If somebody has good reason, he must be ruling class. Okay, right. In Indian system also, there is some kind of thing. Rajas. Sattvic guna, rajas guna, tamas guna. There are three kind of things. Tamas guna is again the appetite. Sattvic guna is again the person who is all knowledgeable, who has achieved that kind of a thing that Plato called idea of form, right? So he had attained that kind of absolute knowledge that Plato is talking about, right? And rajasyuk, again the person who is courageous guna. Okay, so when you are talking about this and if you are supporting it with Indian system, then automatically your marks will go up. So you should never ignore these Indian systems, because whenever you comparatively write it in this manner, automatically your answers will improve and UPSC will all 100% grants you more marks than others. And remember, nobody does that. Very, very few people, there are only few people who will be able to, in Western political thoughts, also link with Indian tradition. And if you do it, because it's Indian civil service, you must know it, right? If you do it in just one line. Don't have to consume so many words. It should not look that you have written entirely on Dharma Shastra. Plato is asked and you have wrote in Dharma Shastra and Artha Shastra answer. No. It should look that you have answered the Plato, but you have supported it from the Indian tradition, right? Okay. Now, one more important things: B.R. Ambedkar, Gandhi, and M.N. Roy. You know, M.N. Roy very rarely asks, but it's very important. The reason is, whenever you are doing some political theory, you will read Marx, and when you read Marx, normally we write criticism of Popper and all, right? Only Western thinkers are criticizing Western thinkers, and we are using those criticism. You can use criticism from Ambedkar and M.N. Roy to criticize Marx. If somebody has given criticism of Popper and you have given criticism of M.N. Roy and Ambedkar as well, your marks will be higher than that post, because you have criticized Western thinkers with Indian thinkers. Why am I saying that? UPSC has asked many times question on Eurocentricism. There is a term, Eurocentricism, in Western political thought, right? whether it's IR, whether it's political thinker, they have originated in a particular social, socio-economic and political context, right? So that Eurocentricism is persistent. If you use those methods to analyze Indian society, you are bound to fail. You are 100% going to fail. That means you also have to tell the examiner that I also understand the Indian system. It's not that I just understand the, for example, if Marx is saying that classes are antagonist classes are sufficient to explain society. Okay, but Ambedkar is saying that classes in Indian context does not fit because here concept of caste is also there. So Indian Marxists were doing is imposing classes in a caste divided society. So their theoretical analysis was wrong, and that's why their practical suggestions were also wrong, right? So same thing can happen with you also. If you are seeing the whole world or Indian system solely through the eyes of vision or tools of the Western political thought, then you might also do same kind of mistake. So it is also important to show examiner that you understand the Indian system and you are not bounded by that Eurocentricism, right? Getting my point? Okay. Western border. Again, here also, Hannah Arendt, you will not find many places. Very complicated thinker, so many dimensions in her, and very important. Not just, it can be asked very often, but it is she is also important because criticism provided by her can be used in other thinkers also, and this criticism will hold more value because she is woman. Criticism by feminism of some ideology is more important than criticism by other, because what it will reflect. Feminist. Not just feminists, women are weaker sections, they are vulnerable sections. If you use more of criticism from feminism, then it will reflect that you take care of views of vulnerable sections as well. There is a syllabus in GS, in syllabus, there is a topic on vulnerable sections, right? So why they have put it? They want to know if you can really appreciate their concerns or not. So if you bring in concerns from feminism, from Ambedkar, concerns from vulnerable sections into your answer, that means you have that quality, right? So what I have said in the beginning itself, that you got to tell the examiner that you are perfect, absolute bureaucratic material, right? And these are the small techniques through which you can tell the examiner that you have those capability, okay? So Hannah Arendt, Gramsci, these are two thinkers that you will not find a lot of written. If the normal books that we read, I don't want to name them, but you know that those books that we follow, Hannah Arendt, Gramsci, is very rarely touched in that. And whatever is touched is not sufficient to answer UPSC question, because UPSC asks quite complicated questions from these two topics. For example, they've asked the role of ideology in Hannah Arendt's concept. So it's nowhere given. In one book, it is given, that's also in just three lines, you know. So you got to do some serious hard work to read her, right? So you don't have to do it here. I will provide every dimension of it, reasonable material, qualitative material backed by valid criticism, scholarly opinion, compared with Indian system, right? We will also give you comparison with Indian system. So basically all the ammunition will be given to you so that you can use it in examination, right? Okay, here again, this is also one of the seriously neglected area of UPSC, and one question is certainly there from these two topics. Perspective on Indian National Movement, liberal, socialist, Marxist, radical, humanist, and Dalit. Again, no quality material, to be honest, in this perspective. I have to read at least 30 to 40 books to extract things relevant to this. You know, because, and mostly people will read from the top. You know, they will just read some, they will just make some of one or two points, and if question is twisted, they are gone. ओके, सो वी डोंट वॉन्ट दैट थिंग टू हैपन. सो वी हैव प्रिपेयर्ड गुड मटीरियल फॉर दीज थिंग्स. एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग इज दैट यू गॉट टू नो इट बिकॉज एवरी ईयर क्वेश्चन इज देयर, राइट? एंड इट्स ईजी टॉपिक, इट्स नॉट डिफिकल्ट. यू डोंट हैव टू रीड मोर देन टू पेजेस ऑन ईच ऑफ द टॉपिक, राइट? सो टू पेजेस मटीरियल मोर देन सफिशियंट फॉर यू. इवन टू पेजेस आर टू मच, आई थिंक इट्स वन एंड हाफ पेजेस मोर देन सफिशियंट. ओके, हाँ, इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग इज, वन मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट थिंग, दैट वेन इट इज अबाउट परस्पेक्टिव्स ऑन इंडियन नेशनल मूवमेंट, यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड वन थिंग, दैट परस्पेक्टिव इज बेसिकली आइडियोलॉजिकल व्यू पॉइंट, राइट? इट इज नॉट द नरेशन ऑफ इंसिडेंट्स ऑफ इंडियन नेशनल मूवमेंट कि भाई पूना पैक्ट हुआ, ये हुआ, वो हुआ, नहीं. आपको लिबरल एंगल से इंडियन नेशनल मूवमेंट को एनालाइज करना है. यू हैव टू एनालाइज इंडियन नेशनल मूवमेंट फ्रॉम लिबरल एंगल. यू हैव टू एनालाइज इट फ्रॉम सोशलिस्ट एंड मार्क्सिस्ट एंगल. सो देयर रेलेवेंट थिंकर्स, देयर रेलेवेंट स्कॉलर हु हैव रिटन अंडर लिबरल, सोशलिस्ट एंड मार्क्सिस्ट स्कूल ऑफ थॉट, हु हैव एनालाइज्ड इंडियन हिस्ट्री फ्रॉम द रिस्पेक्टिव स्कूल ऑफ थॉट. ओके, सो यू गॉट टू इनकॉर्पोरेट द ओपिनियन ऑफ दोज स्कॉलर्स, राइट? इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, टेक द टॉपिक ऑफ मार्क्सिस्ट. इन मार्क्सिज्म देयर इज समथिंग कॉल्ड ग्राम्स्कियन कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ वॉर ऑफ पोजिशन. इफ यू हैव रेड, यू मोस्ट ऑफ यू मस्ट हैव रेड द बुक कॉल्ड बिपिन चंद्रा, इंडियन फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल. इफ यू रीड द बिपिन चंद्रा, द वॉर ऑफ पोजिशन एंगल इज गिवन इन दैट एटलीस्ट इन टू चैप्टर्स. First in introduction, and then in debate between Swarajist, no changers and all, that chapter is there. So they are basically, when you are reading Indian national movement from Bipin Chandra, you will have to read it for GS purpose. Okay, you also extract important things from there that you can use in this topic. You can talk about war of position, Bipin Chandra's view on Indian National Movement using war of position as a tool of analysis, right? So you can add these things into the relevant topic of your syllabus. Okay, then again we read a lot about it in GS, parliament, legislature, all these things. Okay, so what happens that because we are reading this too much from GS, when we write in political science, our answer become very generalistic, right? It doesn't look like a political science answer. So that's why it's very important to have a particular orientation towards these topics when it comes to political science. Eh? This is not to say that you got to use theories here. No, only technical or scientific language is required. If you are writing answers on these topics, then it should look political science answer, not a GS answer. So how to use those scientific terms? What kind of scientific terms you can use? For example, if question is on party system, right? So party system, what is the job of a party? Aggregating the interest of all. There are different interests in society. Labor class has its own interest. Women's interest, vulnerable sections interest, children's interest, right? Environmental groups interest. What is the job of what these groups are doing? They're articulating a particular interest, right? What is political party doing? They're aggregating these interests and balancing it so that these can be reflected in their policies, right? So articulation of interest, aggregation of interest, these are technical and scientific terms. Right, so when you're writing about party system, you must make use of these concepts and terms, right? You don't have to explain them. You don't have to explain what is articulation of interest, what is aggregation of, no. You just have to use it so that examiner understand that yes, you have read something. For example, you can make use of concepts like power asymmetry in society. Right. If a question was on, I think in 2020 itself, women empowerment, role of Panchayati Raj in women empowerment. Right. So you can write that there are power asymmetries in society because Indian society is patriarchal in nature. That's why women are not hierarchically inferior to men. So this results in a power asymmetry. And that power asymmetry is reflected in the government policy as well. You know, so you can write in this kind of scientific language. Always to score good marks and to project to the examiner that yes, you have understand the syllabus. Okay. One question is always there from this. Statutory institutions, government, election. This year itself, there was election commission and CAG in one question. Within one question, they have asked two topics, CAG and election commission. And the problem is there, not much is given about these topics. At least from the standpoint of political science. For example, and they are asking innovative questions. This year they have asked 20 years role. You have to analyze last 20 years role and achievements of CAG and Election Commission. Now, where in which book they will give you 20 years, they will list down the Election Commission did in last 20 years so and so things. No. So how do you get it? You get it from newspaper, right? When you study political science, you see this syllabus, you do your own research, so that you collect enough materials to tackle any kind of question that might come from this topic, right? So there are two ways. One, as I've said in the beginning, understand the syllabus. So you got to understand the syllabus, right? Once you understand, you know from the newspaper what things you got to read, what you got not to read, right? So you know election commission and CAG is there. So whenever news is there regarding CAG, regarding election commission, you will separately note it down, right? Important key points, you will note it down, right? So at the end of the year, you have reasonable material on each of. Something is there on National Commission of Scheduled Caste, any of the commission, you can note it down separately, okay? And also, if you find that not enough or reasonable material is collected by you, you can always do your own research. You can always Google and find it out. But when you are coming here, you don't have to do it. You don't have to do all this labor. We will provide you enough material so that you can tackle any kind of question that might come from it. Because remember one thing, that question, not all questions will be as expected as by you. You might expect something, but you might get something else. So you also got to know how to use the knowledge, how to play with the knowledge. You might have to answer the question with existing knowledge that you have, right? That's why it is important to know how to play with the knowledge that you have. Same thing can be asked, can be answered by the same knowledge. You don't have to read something different for different questions. Okay. Most of the successful candidates, they have this quality. That question is on some topic that they have no clue about, they still are managed to write reasonably good answer by just using the common sense. Right? So we will also work upon that common sense thing, so that from the limited knowledge that you have, because you cannot read everything. You have to read limited things. The thing is, difference is that you got to understand the application of that. We have read something in history. We have read Nehru report. We have read separate electorate system. All these things we have read, right? But we got to understand the multiple application of that. For example, if question is on communalism, you can use that knowledge from history. Separate electorate, which sowed the seeds of communalism in India. Knowledge is from its history, but it can be applied in communalism, it can be applied in secularism, right? There are provisions in Constitution of India related to communalism and secularism that you can use. So knowledge is coming from Constitution, knowledge is coming from history, but you can use it in questions that are non-polity and non-history questions. So there are multiple applications of same knowledge. You got to understand those applications as well. The more you understand the application, the easier it will be for you to play with the knowledge, right? So we will also focus on that aspect, एटलीस्ट वी कैन गाइड यू हाउ टू डू इट. ओके, अगेन कास्ट रिलीजन एंड एथनीसिटी, ईदर द रोल ऑफ रिलीजन इन पॉलिटिक्स, ईदर द रोल ऑफ कास्ट इन पॉलिटिक्स, एवरी ईयर यू विल फाइंड वन क्वेश्चन. दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक. इनफैक्ट यूपीएससी इज मेकिंग श्योर दैट एटलीस्ट फ्रॉम एवरी टॉपिक दे आर एबल टू प्लेस वन क्वेश्चन, एटलीस्ट फ्रॉम एवरी टॉपिक. सो इफ दे हैव गिवन टॉपिक नंबर 6, फ्रॉम दैट टॉपिक देर आर लॉट्स ऑफ सब टॉपिक्स, बट एटलीस्ट वन सब टॉपिक यू विल फाइंड. ओके, पार्टी सिस्टम आई हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस हाउ टू अप्रोच इट. सोशल मूवमेंट, ओके, सोशल मूवमेंट नॉट एवरी ईयर बट एवरी अल्टरनेट और एवरी टू ईयर वन क्वेश्चन विल बी देयर. नाउ दिस इज वेरी स्मॉल टॉपिक, कंपैरेटिव पॉलिटिक्स. ओके, बट यू विल फाइंड इफ यू एनालाइज लास्ट 10 ईयर क्वेश्चंस, एवरी ईयर डिफरेंट क्वेश्चन इज कमिंग. One year they are asking political sociology approach, other year they are asking political economy approach. Okay, every year different question is coming from this topic. So we will, but you don't have to read it in depth. That's important thing. You have to have reasonable syllabus, reasonable content, so that you can address, because simple questions, they are asking direct questions. They're not twisting the questions too much from this topic, and there are other topics also from where the direct questions are coming, right? So you don't have to work too hard on these topics. As I have discussed approaches, I have talked about approaches to political science, right? From that topic itself, questions are coming very simple, not very complicated. Direct questions are coming. So from these two topics, you don't have to do too much of hard work. Okay, now we come to the 5th topic. Approaches to the study of Indian relations, idealist, realist, Marxist function. These are theoretical topics, realism, Marxism, theories of those in international relations. They have very rarely asked idealism. Idealist, in 2020 they have asked. And the fact is, they have not just, it's a very old tradition, you have to understand. It was a tradition that has its roots in interwar years, between First World War and Second World War. And it came as a counter to realist tradition. Realist thought that conflict is inevitable, war is likely, right? They've talked about balance of power. They have also talked about causes of war. They said that anarchy is the cause, main cause of the war, right? They have borrowed so many assumptions from realism. They agreed with state-centric system, that realists also agree. They also agreed with anarchy, that realists talk about, that anarchy results in war. I can discuss them in some detail. But first, what I'm trying to make the point, I'll make it, okay. Anarchy, realism and idealism, both are agreeing to. But idealism is different, that anarchy is not the cause of war for idealism. Okay, idealism is saying balance of power is cause of war. Some are saying balance of power, some are saying imperialism is the cause of war, right? So there are different perspective, different reason they're providing for cause of war. So there are certain assumptions that are common with realism. There are certain things that are different from realism. So you got to read and study in comparative manner, because the context of ideology is to challenge, idealism is to challenge realism, right? So you cannot discontext it. You got to study it within the context itself. And that context have to be reflected in your answer. This year, they have asked the assumptions in idealism. Okay, so when they have asked the assumptions, then those assumptions were not disconnected with realism. So you got to write a comparative answer. You got to also compare that similar to realism, they are saying that. Different to realism, they are saying this, right? So examiner will understand that you have understood the context of the थ्योरी. नाउ ओके लेट्स टॉक अबाउट समथिंग अबाउट रियलिज्म. व्हेन आई वाज डिस्कसिंग एनार्की, रियलिज्म इज सेइंग दैट द सिस्टम, इंटरनेशनल सिस्टम हैज सम कैरेक्टरिस्टिक एंड एनार्की इज इंपॉर्टेंट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ दैट सिस्टम. एनार्की मीन्स देर इज नो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट टू रन, देर इज नो लॉ. एंड इफ देर इज नो लॉ, इमेजिन ए सोसाइटी वेर देर इज नो गवर्नमेंट. यू हैव रेड हॉब्स, थॉमस हॉब्स. ओके, सो व्हाट थॉमस हॉब्स सेज दैट देर इज ए सोसाइटी, इफ देर इज नो गवर्नेंस, देर इज अ लॉ ऑफ नेचर, देन लाइफ विल बी नेस्टी, ब्रूटिश एंड शॉर्ट, बिकॉज एवरीबडी विल ट्राई टू मेक सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट द प्रायोरिटी, एंड इन ऑर्डर टू अचीव इज सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट विल हर्ट अदर्स इंटरेस्ट, राइट. सो देर इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट वॉर लाइक सिचुएशन, कॉन्फ्लिक्ट लाइक सिचुएशन इज ऑलवेज प्रेजेंट. इंटरनेशनल सिस्टम इज लाइक दैट. रियलिज्म इज सेइंग दैट इट इज, देर इज नो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट, राइट. दे आर सेइंग दैट देर इज, देर आर नो कॉन्क्रीट लॉ दैट आर बैक्ड बाय फोर्स. ओके, देर आर कस्टमरी लॉज, देर आर सम थिंग्स, लीगल थिंग्स, बट देर नॉट बैक्ड बाय द फोर्स, सम कॉन्क्रीट फोर्स दैट इफ समबडी किल्स समवन देन पुलिस विल कम एंड कैच हिम. बट दिस इज नॉट द केस इन इंटरनेशनल सिस्टम. China is doing so many things, but nobody is able to punish it, right? The pandemic is spread across the globe, but there is no police to punish China, right? So it is in anarchy and there is no accountability, not much accountability. And if there is accountability, there is no mechanism to enforce the accountability. So every state has a challenge of security, of survival, because other states intention is not known. So what is the one more assumption? Intention. Other state has the capability to hurt India. China has the capability to hurt India. Pakistan has the capability. US has the capability to hurt India, right? That's the one thing. Second thing is anarchy. There is no government. If India is hurt, India can go nowhere. It's self-help system. You got to help yourself because you have nowhere to go, right? So anarchy, capability to hurt others, and intention is not known, the third assumption. So it is an environment in which mistrust is bound to arise. Okay, so only insurance against your material well-being is balance of power. You got to balance. You can form, there are different ways of balancing, forming coalitions, upgrading your military capabilities, etc. and etc. You got to balance. Only through balancing you can survive. Okay, then there are different strands within this realism itself who are taking slightly different offensive realism, defensive realism, starting from Hans Morgenthau, who basically traced human nature, that every crisis, every conflict is because of human nature. Human nature itself is power-seeking. And since states are ruled by humans, the states are also power-seeking. And also, on top of it, there is anarchy. So all these things makes a toxic cocktail in which pessimism persists, mistrust is there, and that's why states act to secure themselves. And when they try to secure themselves, they will build armors, they will form coalition. This behavior of state again creates suspicions in the mind of rivals. India has recently formed Quad with USA. So it is creating suspicion in mind of China, right? So China has done Galwan incident. It is creating suspicion in India's mind. So what we are doing? We are consolidifying Quad even more, right? So action reaction is creating more of suspicion, more of mistrust, backed by international system, anarchy, self-help, distribution of power. All these things are basic element. So in that backdrop, conflict is bound to arise. Idealist challenges that. They're agreeing that anarchy is there, potential of conflict is there, but war is not necessarily result of the failure of balance of power. You know, they are saying that imperialism प्रोटेक्शनिज्म, नो नॉन प्रेजेंस ऑफ एनी मैकेनिज्म टू एडजुडिकेट, देर इज नो लीगल मैकेनिज्म टू एडजुडिकेट द कन्फ्लिक्ट बिटवीन द टू. सो दीज आर द प्राइम रीजन्स फॉर विच वार अकर्स. बिकॉज इफ फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई फील दैट आई एम अनजस्टिफाइडली ट्रीटेड, सो आई हैव लेजिटिमेट ग्रीवेंस, सो आई कैन डू एनी थिंग एट माई डिस्पोजल टू यू नो डू जस्टिस विद मी. राइट, जर्मनी इज एग्जाम्पल. आफ्टर वर्ल्ड वॉर सर्टेन टेरिटरीज वर टेकिंग अबाउट अवे फ्रॉम जर्मनी. दे फेल्ट ह्यूमिलेटेड, दे फेल्ट दैट वी वर जस्ट अनजस्टिफाइडली ट्रीटेड, यू नो द जस्टिस हैज नॉट बीन सर्व टू अस. सो राइज ऑफ हिटलर एंड द सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर. राइट, सो दे आर सेइंग दैट रीजन्स आर डिफरेंट एज नॉट प्रीस्ड बाय रियलिस्ट एंड दे आर प्रोवाइडिंग देयर सोल्यूशन एज वेल. Mechanism to educate, for example, International Court of Justice, collective security they are talking about, that they we have to have mechanism of collective security. If anyone defects, other parties come together and punishes the defector so that they have no incentive to go to war. They are saying the democratization, democratic peace thesis of Kant, Immanuel Kant. They are saying the democratic countries are less likely to go to war. Right? They're providing certain reasons for that. Okay, so these are the things. Ab now question in UPSC was that discuss the relevance in contemporary times, because as I've said, it is an old theory, and now you have to give the relevance in contemporary time. How are you going to do it? The only thing is that you understand the theory and link the examples from contemporary developments, right? Jaise ki, for example, they are talking about democratic procedures, but is there democracy in international system? UNSC Security Council, permanent five has veto. That means what? India, country like India, are treated unjustifiably. We are 1/6 of the world humanity. We don't have the permanent seat. That means there is injustice towards us. So there is a relevance to this theory. You can say that परमानेंट सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल रिफॉर्म के लिए है ना. एडजुडिकेशन की बात करें हम, इंटरनेशनल कोर्ट ऑफ जस्टिस है यूएन के अंदर, है ना, तो दैट मींस वो इस थ्योरी का रेलिवेंस तो है कहीं ना कहीं. देर इज सम रेलिवेंस ऑफ दिस थ्योरी. आप वी कैन टॉक अबाउट इंडिया बांग्लादेश वेंट टू इंटरनेशनल आर्बिट्रेशन टू सेटल टेरिटोरियल डिस्प्यूट. राइट, इट कुड हैव इजिली कन्वर्टेड इन टू अ वॉर. बांग्लादेश वॉज सींग दैट इंडिया is not treating us fairly. India was saying that they are not treating us fairly. So we said that, okay, let's take it to arbitration. And whatever the judgment comes, we will accept it. We have accepted it. So the territorial dispute has been settled. A potential conflict area has been settled. Right? So you can relate with these examples. Getting my point? And for you to do it all alone will be difficult. That's my what I'm saying. You know, first thing, it will be difficult to know what to do, and second thing, if you know it, how to do is even more challenging. Okay, that's why we are here. That's where our support and assistance will help you. Okay. Now, okay, changing international political order. Here, a very important point I am trying to make. The point is political order. You got to understand. Syllabus is international relations. The heading of the syllabus is what? International relations, PSIR, political science and international relations. It is not international politics. Getting my point? There is difference. There is a book by Kenneth Walls, Theory of International Politics, in which he says that political causes has economic, sociological, every kind of environmental consequence. So when you are talking about international politics, you are analyzing the politics and seeing the consequences of that, multiple dimensions of the consequences of that. Economic consequences of politics, for example. Right? But when you talk about international relations, you are talking about whole of the issues, environmental, economic, social, cultural, all aspects. ओके सो सिलेबस हियर इज सेइंग चेंजिंग इंटरनेशनल पॉलिटिकल ऑर्डर्स, दैट मीन्स राइज ऑफ सुपर पावर, स्ट्रेटेजिक आइडियोलॉजी, आर्म्स रेस, ऑल दीज टॉपिक्स हैव टू बी डेल्ट इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ पॉलिटिकल ऑर्डर. सो इफ समथिंग इज देयर फ्रॉम दिस टॉपिक, एम्स एंड अचीवमेंट्स ऑन नॉन नैम फॉर एग्जाम्पल, सो यू गॉट टू अंडरस्टैंड इट इज फ्रॉम द पॉलिटिकल ऑर्डर, राइट? सो यू गॉट टू लुक फॉर द पॉलिटिकल कॉजेज एंड लिंक इट विद सोशो इकोनॉमिक कल्चरल इफेक्ट्स. ओके सो इट इज वेरी, दैट्स वाई आई हैव सेड दैट इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू अंडरस्टैंड द सिलेबस. प्रॉब्लम इज दैट वी हैव नोन द सिलेबस, वी हैव मार्क्ड इट अप, बट वी हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड इट. ओके एंड यस, फ्रॉम नॉन अलाइनमेंट दिस इज द मोस्ट रिपीटेड क्वेश्चन एंड मोस्टली दे आर आस्किंग डायरेक्टली. इफ क्वेश्चन इज इस सिलेबस इज सेइंग नॉन अलाइनमेंट, एम्स एंड अचीवमेंट, रेलेवेंस ऑफ नैम, दे आर आस्किंग डायरेक्टली डिस्कस द रेलेवेंस ऑफ नैम इन कंटेम्पररी टाइम एंड स्टिल एवरी ईयर दे आर आस्किंग, स्टिल नो बडी इज एबल टू आंसर इट सेटिस्फैक्ट्री. प्रॉब्लम इज दैट दे डोंट हैव, इट इज नॉट रिटन इन एनी बुक, रेलेवेंस ऑफ नैम इन कंटेम्पररी. इफ देर इज बुक, देर इज सम बुक, नो बडी नोज इट, राइट? सो देर इज लॉट ऑफ हार्ड वर्क दैट स्टूडेंट और एस्पिरेंट्स put in. Okay, again collapse of Soviet Union, these are all three topics under that changing political order. Ab now I can give you a sketch of how you should prepare. You know, whenever you are reading contemporary affairs, you keep this in mind: what are the changes occurring, whatever the changes are happening, you keep that change in mind. Okay, and then make two separate columns. One is causes, one is effects. Okay. For example, there was America First policy by Donald Trump. You list down the causes. Wherever the something related to it come in newspaper, it will always has cause and effect thing. List down the causes separately and effects separately. Right? Whenever something related to BRI, China's Chinese dream, for America First policies appearing, you make a separate note, because it is very important development in relation to changing political order, right? So you have cause and effect written, it you can easily revise it, because questions are coming like that. Questions was recently, I think 2018, there was a question on impact of America First and Chinese dreams on global political order, right? So it was from there itself. So when you have cause and effect kind of a separately written, then you can easily and subdivide them: economic causes, political causes, economic effect, political effect, geostrategic effect, geoeconomic effects, subdivide them further, right? And once you subdivide it accordingly in your notes, automatically in your answer it will come like that. You don't have to think too much in your exam, because there is barely some time to think, right? So automatically your hand will know that you got to subdivide them: economic causes separately, social causes separately, everything you will do in quick time. Okay, regionalization of world politics, EU Asia is enough. SAARC, they are frequently asking. This year 2020 itself there was question on SAARC, but there is one more place where they have placed SAARC: regional cooperation, SAARC past performance and future prospect, India and South Asia. So there are two places where SAARC is there in the syllabus. One, in the context of regionalization of world politics. Okay. Other, in the context of India and South Asia. Here it is not, the term is used, regional cooperation. It is not the regionalization. So there is difference between regionalization and regional cooperation. Okay. So first you got to understand the difference, and then you got to tackle the syllabus accordingly. Okay. For example, we can take India's Look East policy. Up India's Look East policy, any policy of any country has a specific context and purpose. राइट, एंड दैट पॉलिसी इज इवॉल्विंग विद टाइम डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द इवॉल्विंग नेशनल इंटरेस्ट ऑफ अ कंट्री. ओके, नेशनल इंटरेस्ट इज अ पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक इन द सिलेबस इटसेल्फ. नेशनल इंटरेस्ट, बैलेंस ऑफ पावर, ऑल दिस थिंग्स, देर इज अ पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक इन द सिलेबस इटसेल्फ. सो इंडियाज लुकिस्ट पॉलिसी इज ऑल्सो आउटकम ऑफ पर्टिकुलर सर्कमस्टांस, राइट, पर्टिकुलर नेशनल इंटरेस्ट, एंड इट इज स्टिल इवॉल्विंग एज आवर नेशनल इंटरेस्ट इज इवॉल्विंग विद द चेंजिंग नीड्स ऑफ द टाइम. राइट, लेट्स डिस्कस द कॉन्टेक्स्ट. इंडियाज लुकिस्ट पॉलिसी वॉज अनाउंस्ड आई थिंक इन 1992. राइट, द गवर्नमेंट वॉज no, not Vajpayee. He was Narasimha Rao was Prime Minister of India. We had just had a balance of payment crisis in 89, and there was Gulf War, Kuwait crisis, Iraq-Kuwait crisis in the Gulf. So it has two contexts to it. One is international, other is domestic. What domestic? That shortage of foreign exchange reserves. There were very little foreign exchange reserves with us, right? Second thing, crisis in Gulf. What crisis in Gulf did? That it dried up the sources of remittances. The dollars were coming from Gulf. It affected that. Second thing, it shot up the prices of oil. Oil prices were shot up. So what happened? That import bill increased. So this also created balance of payment for India. And why all it happened? Because we were too much reliant on West. We were too much dependent on Gulf for our needs. So what India realized that we got to diversify. So instead of being too much relying on West, you got to look East. Okay. So in that context, India's Lukist policy was born, that we integrate little more with Eastern countries, and East Asia miracle was happening. East Asian countries were booming economically. So all the international and domestic factors collided together to force India to start its Lukist policy. Now Lukist policy has been turned into Act East policy. Why? Because needs of countries have evolved, national interests have changed, so policy also have to evolve. Now Northeast India has a very central position in Lukist policy. Question has also come, discuss the significance of looking policy in the context of development in Northeast India. I think 2018 itself this question was there. So with the changing needs of time, changing national interest, changing international and domestic environment, our policy is also changing and responding to those changes. Okay, there is a topic in the syllabus, continuity and change in the Indian foreign policy. Okay, so you can always interlink different topics. Why I'm talking about these things? Because it is always very important to correlate. And correlation has to be logical. It has to be logical. So in order to explain how you can correlate things and logically correlate things, I have taken this example. Okay. Okay. Now, this is a kind of a model that I have developed, or what I can say, that I have understood with the experience, that what kind of a answer that is required here. First thing, that core idea, if political theory is there, if Western political thinking is there, whatever the question is there, core idea have to be present. You cannot afford to miss core idea, because examiner is looking for that core idea. And you also underline it, right? So you got to prepare your notes accordingly, underlining the core idea and memorizing it again and again, and also using it in test, right? सेकेंड थिंग इज कीवर्ड्स, कीवर्ड्स हैव टू बी रिमेंबर्ड एंड दे ऑल्सो हैव टू बी अंडरलाइंड. यू शुड नॉट मिस द कीवर्ड्स. इफ मार्क्सिज्म इज आस्क्ड, यू शुड नॉट आस्क इट, राइट इट जनरलिस्टिकली. यू गॉट टू टॉक अबाउट डायरेक्टिक मटीरियलिज्म, है, यू गॉट टू टॉक अबाउट एंटागोनिज्म ऑफ क्लासेस, राइट. देर आर सर्टेन टर्मिनोलॉजी, वोकैबुलरी ऑफ एवरी आइडियोलॉजी. So you got to follow that vocabulary. If Marxism, if Gramsci is there, you got to talk about original, John Rawls is there, then you got to talk about original position, right? Gramsci mein war of position, its various concept of organic intellectual, traditional intellectual, these are vocabularies of particular thinkers and ideologies. So those vocabulary must find mention in your answer. Second thing is, you must use significance. When you are writing introduction, it is most challenging for any student is writing introduction and conclusion. And there are separate marks for introduction and conclusion. GS as well as political science. If you have missed the conclusion, if you did not write introduction, you lose your marks. There are separate marks allocated for introduction and conclusion as well. Many students avoid writing conclusion. Many students avoid writing introduction. So, first thing is that how to write an introduction. There are multiple ways. One way is you can provide the context. In political science, I am talking about generally. Even in GS, you can use that technique. You can provide the context. Jaise, for example, I have provided the context of idealism, right? In what condition that it has given. But that contextual context has to be theoretical. That has to be remembered. It should not be the incidents, narration of incidents. For example, World War happened and so idealism has born. No, it should mention the core ideas of the theory, like anarchical system, balance of power in realism. Idealism came and they modified it. So in that thing, in that sense, you can talk about in introduction. That means you have provided the theoretical context. Once you have provided the theoretical context, you can come into the body. Whatever is asked in the, for example, question was on assumptions in idealism. Then you can list down the various assumptions. These are the assumptions. Okay. Now, significance is the second thing. You can also highlight the significance of the theory in conclusion or introduction, depending upon the question. Obviously, question has to be assessed. If you feel that I will discuss when we will deal with the program, if you feel that significance has to be provided, then you can go for it. If you feel that context has to be provided, then, and there are other things also, other variations also that we will discuss depending upon the questions. Second thing is logical correlation that I have just talked about with the example of Lucky's policy. Similarly, this logical correlation has to be shown in theory, in international relations, in practical questions, in every kind of questions. This logical correlation aspect also has to be there in your answer. Comparative analysis, just I have explained. If you are talking about idealism, do it comparatively. Question is on idealism. You have to remember, question is on idealism. That it should look like a question answer on idealism. But always you to provide the context, to provide the comparative analysis, always you can make two or three lines on realism itself, right? So you can convey to the examiner that question answer is on idealism, but only the correlation and comparative analysis is given just to substantiate what you are saying, right? This is also where you can take the edge over others, because most of the candidates don't use it. They don't compare when they are writing. If question is on idealism, they will simply narrate whatever they know about idealism and move on, right? They don't dare to or care to give some correlated ideas. If you do it, you will have edge over others. That means you will get some additional half marks over others, and the difference is of half marks only, right? So these are the some things that will give you that additional half mark, right? So if you are doing logical correlation well, you are providing some comparative analysis, कंपैरिजन विद इंडियन सिस्टम, एज आई हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट बिफोर, दैट कंपैरिजन विद इंडियन सिस्टम इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, बिकॉज एज आई हैव सेड द थ्योरीज आर यूरोसेंट्रिक, द होल वेस्टर्न थ्योरीज आर यूरोसेंट्रिक, सो यू गॉट टू एक्सट्रैक्ट फ्रॉम यूरोसेंट्रिसिज्म एंड अलाइन विद द इंडियन सिस्टम, सो यू गॉट टू कंपेयर, राइट? कंपेरिजन विद इंडियन सिस्टम इज ऑल्सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. क्रिटिसिज्म वाई इंडियन पॉलिटिकल थिंकर, एज आई हैव सेड यू दैट थ्योरीज आर यूरोसेंट्रिक, सो इफ यू आर प्रोवाइडिंग इंडियन पॉलिटिकल थिंकर्स क्रिटिसिज्म, इंडियन पॉलिटिकल थिंकर्स हैव गिवन देयर आइडियाज ग्रोन आउट ऑफ इंडियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट, अंडरस्टैंडिंग? इंडियन पॉलिटिकल थिंकर्स आर जनरेटिंग आइडियाज ग्रोन आउट ऑफ इंडियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट, सो दैट्स वाई देयर क्रिटिसिज्म इज मोर रेलिवेंट in light of Eurocentricism of Western political thought. Okay, so this will always score you more marks. That doesn't mean that you should not use Western political thinkers' criticism. Wherever you can, you use it. In two questions, in three questions, you can do it, you use it. Similarly, comparison with Indian system, you will not be able to do it in all the questions. But in four or five questions, you will be easily able to do it, you do it, right? So those half of marks will add up and it will add 30 to 40 marks to your score. Substantiation by using expert opinions or scholarly views. You know, as I've said, you cannot form your opinion based on hearsay. Okay, it has to be credible because you are going to be bureaucrat, right? So you got to substantiate your opinion. Not again, not everywhere you have to do it. One line in one question, for example. If you are saying that Plato was against the liberal values, then you support it with Popper's argument on open, enemies of open society. Say that Karl Popper has said so and so about this aspect. One or two, maximum two. Because word limit is limited, you cannot write just expert opinions because it's about your opinion. This exam is about your opinion. So you give your opinion and support it. Only one or two, maximum two. Okay, getting my point? हाँ, तो ये तो कुछ नहीं है, ये basically इसी का ही है. This is only like this. Su means substantiation. It's basically reverse. Co means core idea, lo means logical correlation, co means comparison with Indian system, su means substantiation. These four are most important out of these six. That's why I have given it separately. If you cannot do all of it, at least you should not avoid to do these four. Su, co, lo, co. Okay. Okay. Let's talk about balance of power. This year there was a question. One question was idealism and its relevance in contemporary times. I have discussed it. One more question was on balance of power. As I've said that they have a tendency to ask similar questions, right? Because they want to know your wholesomeness. They want to see if you have integrity or not. In idealist question itself, you have to talk about balance of power. As I have discussed, in realism scheme of things and idealism scheme of things, balance of power is very prominent theme, right? So you might take some stand there, but the next question forces you to take some other stand. Whether it's good or bad, you got to do all those engineering in this question, okay? So that's why there you got to take balanced stand. As I've said, once you take a balanced stand, it is easier for you to maneuver in next question. Getting my point? So there you have to take a balanced stand. You should neither support idealism wholeheartedly and condemn or ridicule realism, nor you should do it with realism, that you are completely supporting realism and condemning and ridiculing idealism. As I've said, I have given 2-3 examples of relevance of idealism in contemporary time. You should also mention some criticism of idealism, because you have given the relevance, you have also, you should also mention some criticism, because if you have mentioned the criticism, then it is possible for you to criticize it here. If you have done, if you have said all very good, if you have all praised idealism in that question, it will be very difficult for you to do it here. So you will lose marks in both answers, right? So one important criticism of idealism is provided by E.H. Carr. Idealism is saying that human nature can be malleable, it can be modified, right? There is no necessarily conflict of interest, there is harmony of interest, right? Cooperation can happen, conflict can be avoided, and they are providing various methods, as I have discussed, that world government, somebody is talking about we should put in place international economic arrangements, rule-based arrangements, so that dispute can be settled. Somebody is talking about international courts of justice to sort out disputes between them, right? So there are different ways in there, different scholars are giving. Okay. So in balance of power, the logic is that balance of power might provide stability to the system, and idealists are not disagreeing, not agreeing with it. They are saying that it is the root cause of war, right? So we got to put in arrangements through which you can get rid of balance of power mechanism. Okay, here the E.H. Carr's criticism becomes very important. What E.H. Carr is saying? E.H. Carr is saying that against what idealism has hoped, international system is basically a system divided into haves and have-nots. Somebody is very powerful, like United States of America, China. They have all the wealth to enjoy. They have all the facilities for their students. And there are have-nots who do not enjoy those facilities, right? Why this is so? Because there is scarcity. So two things he is saying: scarcity, haves and have-nots. It's a quasi-Marxist interpretation. So this is ये वर्ड क्या? जब मैं बोल रहा हूँ, when I'm saying quasi-Marxism, Marxist interpretation, this is a keyword. Haves and have-nots are keyword. So as I have told you, use keywords, right? So haves and have-nots, and what was the other thing? Haves and have-nots. He's not listening. International system is divided between haves and have-nots, and there is scarcity of resources. You know, so there are not so much of resources that can be distributed to tackle this problem of haves and have-nots. So those people who have so much of resources will want to protect it. And those who don't have less of it will want to gain it. So if I have resources, I don't want to give it to others, but others want it. So there is always a potential of conflict. So always there can be a war, right? So this is a general, very valid and most important criticism of idealism by E.H. Carr. So once you have praised idealism, you have highlighted the good sides of it, you also highlight the bad sides of it. Okay, so your answer is balanced. So you can tackle, you have enough space to maneuver it, because you have made both kind of points over there. So if you want to criticize here, you can criticize. If you want to praise it, you can praise it. You can do play both sides. Okay. Here basically question was on balance of power and its techniques. Okay, discuss what is balance of power and what are the various techniques. Okay. Balance of power is a very ambiguous concept, because there is no strict definition. There is no strict one concept or principle which you can say this is the balance of power and all situation this is going to be applicable, right? So different scholars have outlined differences or different ways in which balance of power concept has been used. For example, Ernest B. Hayes used it. He has identified at least 8 distinct meanings. There are 8 different ways that he has identified the balance of power has been used, right? So, and similarly, दिस इज द रियलिस्ट कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ बैलेंस ऑफ पावर. बैलेंस ऑफ पावर बिगिंस बाय एक्सेप्टिंग बेसिक प्रमाइस ऑफ पावर पॉलिटिक्स. व्हाट इज द बेसिक प्रमाइस ऑफ पावर पॉलिटिक्स अकॉर्डिंग टू रियलिज्म? एनार्की. आई हैव डिस्कस्ड इट. एनार्की, सेल्फ हेल्प सिस्टम, इंटेंशन, राइट? सो बिकॉज ऑफ दैट दीज थ्री थिंग्स बैलेंस ऑफ पावर पॉलिटिक्स प्रिवेल बिकॉज यू डोंट नो द इंटेंशन ऑफ अदर साइड. Other side has the capability and there is no world government to, that you can go up, approach and look for help. So you only can save yourself by balancing against the aggressor, right? I have given examples. Quad, I have talked about Galwan incident and suspicion and mistrust between the two countries. Okay. So when I have given you the example, you can always give these examples here. When you have made a theoretical statement, right? You provided the keyword balance, for example, anarchical world, struggle for power and security. These are the keywords, right? You underline them, right? And you also substantiate with examples, recent example, okay? Since no central authority restrains states or provides protection. This is the second point. Because of anarchy, there is no central authority to adjudicate between the two. Okay, when you have made some point, okay, when, as I have said, you can always support with scholarly views. Here, I have taken the view of this. When you have made that there is no consistency in the balance of power, use of balance of power term, there is no single definition, then you can support it. Balance of power is assigned a number of different and not always compatible meanings in the discourse. So you have taken the expert opinion to substantiate what you have above said, that balance of power is assigned a number of different, not compatible, or not always compatible meanings. Right? Getting my point? Now, when you have highlighted the weaknesses of that, then you must also highlight the utility of it, because it is a part of international relations. You know, you cannot just say that this is not like this and this is bad and this is all those things. You can talk negatively or pessimistically about it, and then examiner will see that, okay, it is pessimistic, then why we are using it? There must be some reason that why we are using it, right? Still, every scholar is talking about balance of power. You know, whether you are talking about realism, whether you are talking about idealism, any school of thought, they are heavily using the term balance of power. Why they are using it? So, as I've said, that significance also can be provided. There is a scholar called White. Okay. He says that international politics is very ambiguous and very fluid. It is changing. So we not need a term or metaphor to capture that dynamism. So that same thing can be used at different context. At some point, if we are talking about the equilibrium between the two powers, then balance of power can be used. If we are talking about attempt to establish that equilibrium by different means, for example, forming alliances and coalition, then we can say that balance of power, we need to achieve the balance of power. That means if there is already established equilibrium or balance of power, then we can use it. If there is an attempt to make it, then you can use it. That means whatever the situation demands, then you can capture it with that terminology. So in need of ambiguity of the international relations, the dynamism of this relation, you got to capture, you got to have a term that can capture all of this, right? So from there it has come that the term, he argues, is flexible and elastic enough to cover all the complexities and contradictions. So it is not that there is contradiction in the term itself. There is contradiction in international relations itself, right? So in order to capture that contradiction, you got to have a term, right? So this is an argument in support of, and it is also given by the expert. He is a very renowned expert who has extensively worked on the balance of power itself. Okay, so the moment you use the word Morton Kaplan, White, examiner will know that, that person knows balance of power, because these are very renowned scholars who have worked extensively on the subject itself. They are double PhD in balance of power itself. Okay. Now, there are different ways in which the concept has been used. White also highlights 9 different ways. Earlier, we have talked about Ernest B. Hass, who has identified 8 different ways. Now, we are talking about White, who has identified 9 different ways. One, an even distribution of power. For example, when the power is evenly distributed, we are saying that there is balance of power. And now the second statement is, the principle that power ought to be evenly distributed. What is the difference between those two statements?
He's asking us to be evenly distributed. That's a mean.
One is that it is already established. Even distribution of power has already established. Okay. The second is the principle that power ought to be evenly distributed. That means you got to work for it. It is not at automatic. You got to actively cultivate it. How to cultivate it? You got to form coalitions to form balance of power. You got to produce economic and military capabilities within yourself to balance the other power, right? You can divide the other camp, divide and rule. So these are the techniques to maintain balance of power. So question was, what is the balance of power concept and the techniques of that? So we have discussed the different ways, meanings in which the balance of power is used. And now we can talk about the techniques. So these are the 9 ways in which the term can be used. He has given it. Okay, you don't have to write all 9. You don't have to write all 8. You got to mention it, and you may use 1 or 2, right? Or you can use the keywords out of the important, okay? Because there is word limit. You have to understand that. Now, Morgenthau also gave a definition of balance of power. He is very renowned scholar in realism, and his argument carries weight. Right, so he gave 4 rules: divide and rule, dividing the opponent; compensation, providing something to the opponent, providing territory. For example, China has swapped territories with Pakistan, so they have formed an alliance to balance India. Pakistan basically gave territories to China. Actually, Pakistan gave territories to China that were Indian territories, right? And why it gave? Because they want to form alliance with China to counter whom? To balance whom? India. To establish the balance of power, Pakistan gave territories to China. So it was which technique? Compensation. That means China is saying, okay, I am ready to balance India. I am with you. What you are going to give me in return? What are you going to give me in return? Then you have to compensate me. Getting my point? So compensation, because other party is ready to balance and support you, but you got to compensate. There is cost. So Pakistan saying, okay, I'll give you territory. So Pakistan gave. So you can always use example, right? Armaments, countries are building up armaments to balance other. Alliances, quad, you can use here, right? Now, as I have said, वी गॉट टू कंपेयर विद इंडियन सिस्टम. कौटिल्या, पीके गौतम हैज सेड, पीके गौतम इज अगेन रिनाउंड स्कॉलर, दैट मॉर्गेथाउस कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ दिस फोर टेक्निक्स इज हैविली इन्फ्लुएंस्ड बाय उपायास क्लस्टर ऑफ अर्थशास्त्र. उपायास क्लस्टर ऑफ अर्थशास्त्र, व्हाट इज दैट उपायास? साम दाम दंड भेद, हैव यू हर्ड ऑफ देम? ओके, इट्स एग्जैक्टली द सेम. भेद दैट मीन्स डिवाइड एंड रूल. यू गॉट टू भेद द टू into two, divide and rule. Dan, that means compensate, you give something. Dan, you understand dan? Okay. Dand, that means punishment, armaments. Sam, that means alliances and coalitions and counter coalitions. Fourth technique. So basically, Morgenthau has borrowed it from Kautilya itself. And Morgenthau read Kautilya. He has mentioned, he's talked about Kautilya at various places. So that means he was aware of Kautilya. He read these techniques and he put his own stamp and taught it to the world that this is Morgenthau's theory of international politics. But actually he's borrowed it from. Now you can talk about relevance of it. You can use the same thing to justify the relevance of it. Saying that it has been used, the balance of power has been used in India since ancient times. Example, Kautilya. Had it not been relevant, why would somebody be using it from ancient time? Had it not been useful, why would somebody use it? That means it is relevant and significant. Getting my point? There are other techniques that I have also provided. Balancer, that means, as I have given the example of China, you look for a balancer. So Pakistan gave territory to China, said you balance India. Okay, China said, okay, you can compensate me. So you look for balancer. Okay, buffer zones, you create buffer zones. Afghanistan was buffer zone created by the British to guard against the Soviet invasion. Right, to balance you create buffer zone. Same thing is doing is Russia is doing with Ukraine. Russia wants to stop the eastward march of European Union. So to do it, the buffer zone is Ukraine, and Ukraine is red line for Russia. That's why Russia annexed Crimea. Because Ukraine is red line, they don't want that buffer zone to be disturbed. Because they know that if this happens, balance of power will be in favor of Western camp. Right? So Russian will lose. That's why buffer zones are important for maintaining balance of power. Intervention and non-intervention. Americans do it very often. This is also one technique to balance of power. Right? So this is the way we will deal with it, right? We will provide you reasonable material, reasonable knowledge to maneuver and play with, also provide valuable techniques through which you can always make sure that you have sufficient maneuverability, that whatever the question is coming, whatever way the question is asked, you can always tackle that question. If you have any doubts, you can always ask.
Sir, in paper 2, I think which part is the best to answer? Because there are, we need to add,
okay.
We need to take either out of 8 questions, we should take from a party, you know? Which one you suggest, either part B or part A, to take the maximum? Anyway, we should take one question for compulsory.
And two question you have to take from other part.
That question.
I think that you should decide on the spot.
Okay.
If you feel that you can tackle two questions easily from the other part, If you know those questions, you go for it. There is no differentiation of marking. There is no differentiation of marking that some parts fetches you more marks and other part fetches you less marks, right? So if you feel you are confident that these two questions from that section I know very well I can tackle, then you go for it. But if you are confused that you can tackle both, that for example you know all the questions very well, right, then you can always choose. Then you can always exercise this choice that you are in position to handle all the questions. So then you decide on the basis of diversity. For example, if there are too many theoretical questions that you have already written in the exam, then you should choose for more of practical questions because you have already written so many theoretical questions. So now you address the diverse the practical questions just to give that you have diverse command, you have complete command over the subject. Because more the diversity is there, more is the opportunity for examiner to allocate marks to you. If you're writing same things again and again, then marks will not improve, right? So always have to have diverse answers. That's why I always try to tell students to follow one rule: shallow knowledge but dense answer. Dense answer means that you can incorporate as many dimension as possible into your answer. That argument need not be very in-depth argument. It can be shallow. So use shallow arguments but dense answers. Similarly, with the whole paper itself, you can say, to make the whole paper look very dense, you got to attempt from diverse areas. If you have seen that I have attempted too many similar kind of questions, then you can always choose the other question which can give you scope to write different things and obviously get more marks. Anything?
Sir, you have any test series?
Test series?
Yeah,
we will do test series also. Test series, answer writing skills. Mostly answer writing skills, because
daily
answer writing doesn't means every day. You can get some questions on few, because it is also neither feasible nor desirable, because you also have to read general studies, right? So we don't want to overburden you, right? So we will go systematically, because we also have to give you time. For example, if you are daily writing 10 answers, what is the use of it? You cannot, incorporate into your system. You have to internalize it also. When you are knowing something, when you are reading something, you got to internalize it. And to internalize it, you got to spend some time with it, right? So we will do it systematically and methodically, so that ultimate objective of scoring marks is served. As I have said, that somebody is teaching good or bad can be only verified if you are able to solve the questions. If you are not able to solve the questions, you might like somebody's teaching, you might like my teaching, but if I am not able to make you solve the questions, then I'm not a good teacher, right? Because ultimately, by solving the question, you are going to clear this exam. And by talking non-relevant thing just to make lecture interesting, you might be attracted, I might get 10 more candidates, right? But that will not help you. So my objective will be to make you solve the questions in examination, not just to simply attract you, right? So that's why I'm saying that I'm not making too many tall claims that daily 20 questions I will give you, all those things. We will provide you quality questions so that you can test yourself, you spend time with them, you internalize them, internalize the concepts, do reasonable practice, and easily score good marks. Anything?
That's it.
Okay. Okay, friends, thank you so much.